I don't know, we want to let it get us down. Just got on with it.
You've just, of course, come from the third of four nights at Barland.
You're talking about the best venue in the world.
Right, tell us about it.
Well, I didn't really get the chance to talk to you at Christmas, really, so we never got the chance to talk about the Christmas gigs, but we are really, really, you know, over the moon. Apart from being able to do seven gigs there in 3 months, it was a really big gamble going ahead and kind of opening this venue and finding a way, like, the audience have behaved and finding the support they've given us, you know, considering really we've been away for like 14 months, which, as we all know, is a long time in the rock pop world. We naturally feel dead high. I mean, there's never been a better word to describe it, how we're going just now. And I just think we've got eight really tough months coming up, kind of touring, but I kind of think of a better send-off than the audience reaction we're getting in Glasgow. Mm-hmm. And I know a few people said to me, you know, I think you're going a bit over the top on stage just now with some of your patter. But no, I don't think I am, to be honest. I went to hundreds of gigs here, and people used to say, are you the best audience in the world? And I remember being in the audience and thinking, sure, you say that every night, but it's just dead good to be back home and also charging up our energy to set off.
Mm-hmm. After three or four nights at Barland, you know, for the reaction you said really is the best in the world, you're now working your way down the country, Newcastle, Leeds, Birmingham, Manchester, etc., etc. Does that mean that the rest of the tour, in terms of audience response, becomes a bit of an anticlimax?
No, every night's a different kind of challenge, and I think I'd be damned if I know what kind of a crusade we're on, but we're certainly in some kind of a crusade.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that I just think some cities are really, really, you know, emotional, and well, you saw it last week in Belfast. Belfast, Glasgow, you know, Liverpool. I mean, tonight was the wildest looking audience I've ever seen. Up on top of that sort of microphone, mm-hmm. that crow's nest thing, mm-hmm. that I've got, just looking down, it just looked like a sea of flesh. And apart from that, apart from the kind of obvious things, you know, being really kind of positive towards us, the great thing is that looking out, everyone's got a smile on their face, and, mm-hmm. and we're not really, you know, known as a fun band. You tend to think of people like Madness or something, although they're probably one of the most like serious bands I've ever come across. But I don't know. There's just a brilliant kind of feeling in the halls, and I think I just really, really believe in the power of a rock gig again, inverted commas. Mm-hmm. I don't think there'll be anything to touch it. I think, you know, the video world's a world of its own. I think the record world's a world of its own. But I think if you're part of a crowd and the right band, the right venue and the right sound and lights, there'll be nothing to touch it. And you know, I've always enjoyed it, but there's always been or at least for years, there's always been a question mark over how far you could take it, but the question mark's gone.
I've been tagging along since Galway. I've now seen something like 10 Simple Minds shows in a row, and I noticed that on stage there's a lot of giggling, because you're looking out and pointing things out to Charlie, and Mel sitting up on his podium laughing away like a hyena. I mean, what actually is happening when you're looking out? I mean, what kind of mad things are you seeing, whether it's in Barland or whether it's in Belfast or Dublin or whatever? What kind of daft things have you seen up to now?
Well, you know that one in Cork, the guy, the guy who had the, like,
the Eric Morecambe glasses.
His glasses were like, you know, they were like the bottom of milk bottles, and I just love stuff like that. And he saw it for the first number that I was cracking up inside, but I was trying not to burst out, but I nudged Charlie and I pointed down, and Charlie just couldn't contain himself, and I don't know, it's good to break that up, you know.
And there was a famous occasion, of course, at Barland at Christmas, where the chair went right across the front, remember that?
Oh, that was art. That was that was Salvador Dali. That's the
surrealism.
Responsible. Tonight there was a few umbrellas, I think, mm-hmm. as well.
And there was a shoe last night.
Yeah. The other time in Barland I got my shoes nicked from the front of the stage. Someone just pulled them off. I just think I don't know, I think we of them, we just feel dead confident on stage just now, and we can handle, you know, a lot of things. And mm-hmm. I think whereas there is a real good sense of humour, you know, people talk about us in the earlier days and they'll say, like, when you were only selling many records and it must have seemed really bleak and did you feel down? But the answer is no. I think there's a great a great Glaswegian quality, and that is to be able to, you know, no matter how depressing a state you're in, you're never like 10 minutes away from a brilliant laugh.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's always been our kind of lifeblood, I think.
Now, you're not long back from Australia and New Zealand, where you were doing some festivals over there with the Pretenders and Talking Heads, and who was the other band? Peter Gabriel?
No, sorry. Let me see.
Pretenders, Talking Heads, and...
Annie Lennox
and Eurythmics, yeah. Right. I read in one of the pop magazines that you were doing a version of New Gold Dream one night, and you were about to launch into your greatest hits medley of Light My Fire, Papa Was Rolling Stone, and Take Me to the River, when you spotted David Byrne and you changed your mind. Is that right?
Oh, kind of. Anyway, it's an Al Green song. But, no, he was just doing this mad dance at the side of the stage, and... He said, I mean, I think he's a fantastic, like, character. I mean, he's a genius, but, you know...
A bit mad, like all geniuses.
Well, I think, you know, as someone described him, the lights are on, but there's no one home. I think that's the best way. But he's from Glasgow. Actually, no, not from Glasgow, he's from near here, he's from Dumbarton.
That's right.
And Derek Forbes, our bass player, he was really kind of hanging out with them a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And they're a great bunch. It's a pity that they never managed to get over here with the show they were doing, mm-hmm. because it was a mixture of kind of theatre, and it was just did it strange. He would come on at the beginning with a ghetto blaster,
mm-hmm.
playing a drum track, and then he would just pick up the guitar, and it would be I'm tense and nervous and I can't relax down. Don't touch me. He's great, really, really good, manic. And then they did a fantastic light show, and the whole thing would just build up. And the great thing watching them as well, they're another like serious art band, mm-hmm. in vertical colours, mm-hmm. but they're not, they're comedians. Mm. And they have such a good time. In fact, all those festivals have been, including the ones we did in Europe earlier on last year, I think they've really inspired us on to play with such good bands,
mm-hmm.
and for all the bands to get on well with each other, and there's been no one kind of star tripping or anything. It's just a really good atmosphere around these kind of events. It's just a pity that we couldn't have something, mm-hmm. like that, mm-hmm. in Britain, because some of the best bands in the world are taking part, and mm-hmm. still in Britain we're left with the... You know, the Monsters of Rock.
Nebworth and stuff like that, yeah.
I know you like that kind of stuff. Reading and that. But maybe someone will, you know, this year, put on something good in Scotland.
Right, we're going to play a track now from Sparkle in the Rain, Book of Brilliant Things. Tell us a wee bit of how the song, you know, evolved. Where did it come from and when?
The music came from a year back just now. We were stuck in the middle of this bleak countryside in Lincoln, trying to write a... what was to be like the follow-up to New Gold Dream. We managed to come away with five or six kind of musical backing tracks that Charlie, Mick and Mel and Derek came up with. But over the next few months I had a big problem trying to write words to them. I had a lot of things done, but it just seemed, looking at it a bit later, that what we're doing was writing New Gold Dream Part 2.
Mm-hmm.
And the people who had heard the tapes at the time were giving us a lot of encouragement and saying, you know, when, I mean, you heard them and the record company heard them, and I think we'd moved on, but I was feeling, you know, particularly kind of nervous, and it was, I think what it is that we work mostly by instinct, and there I was trying to plan and trying to contrive and just getting in all sorts of muddles and messes. But one of the better ideas from that month was a backing track, which has turned out Book of Brilliant Things. It's a song, the words are almost like a kind of a child's ode or a child's prayer. It's just like, I think you grow up and in the way we're kind of brought up, you get to the age of 20 or 21 and you think, oh, I'm an adult, I've seen it all, I've experienced the world, but I don't think that's the case at all. And in this song, there's a kind of naivety that's intact in it. It's a song about learning and growing up, because I think you're never too old, and you never stop learning as long as you keep your eyes and your ears open. This is the Book of Brilliant Things.
From Sparkle in the Rain, side one, track two, the Book of Brilliant Things. One of the tracks, which opens side two of the album, Lou Reed's Street Hassle. Now, in all the times I've been going to see Simple Minds, to my knowledge, you've only actually done one other cover version. That was White Light, White Heat. Of all the songs that you must have been thinking about covering, why did you choose Street Hassle? I mean, how did that come about?
Just like some of the songs, some of the records we'll be playing later on, it was a particular like favourite for just over the past few years, and then last year on the tour bus we began to play it a lot. I just think it's got such a, it's hardly a rock song. It's more like a classical song. It's like a film or a stage play or something.
I mean, the two covers you've done have both been Lou Reed songs. Is that more than coincidence?
No, I think the Velvet Underground were a giant influence on us, and Lou Reed, I think as a writer, as a journalist more than a pop writer, I think he's fantastic. I think he's one of these people, like, you know, he can write a sort of love song from the most kind of bitter angle. He seems to be one of these guys who understands that love and hate, there's a thin line between, and that he really can express in one verse of that song where he's saying, you know, like love has gone away, she took the ring from my finger, and he's saying like slip away. I just thought it was so desperate, and just it was a good balance to some of the much more kind of, I don't know, optimistic things we were writing about. And I think it was definitely an adventurous thing to do. It happened just before we played in Belgium. Mick McNeil started to play the riff on his keyboard in the rehearsal, and up until then we'd been playing it dead safe on stage, and we went out in Belgium, and in the encore we played this song, and it was amazing to see like a hush go over 60,000 people, and they just kind of, it was just a beautiful kind of a serene feeling, and we just carried it on and in the kind of studio, and there was just something in the song we really, really identified with. I never particularly felt it was a cover version or anything like that. And I think it's obviously a dead sensitive song. A few Lou Reed fans, a few inverted snobs have criticised us for doing it. But I don't know, I'm pretty proud that, you know, Lou Reed's got a song on what was a number one album in Britain.
Has he heard it?
I don't know. You probably won't like it either, but tough luck.
Before we play, let's talk a bit about Steve Lillywhite. In hindsight, I mean, how well do you think that liaison has worked out? Because you came in for quite a bit of stick when he was named as the Sparkle in the Rain producer, and also in some of the album reviews, he was cited as having manipulated and taken over your sound. I mean, in hindsight, how do you view that partnership now?
I just think it was a perfect match. The thing about that, these people, you know, you get people and they talk about production and this shouldn't have been this and this shouldn't have been that. No one knows what sort of a production is until they've actually been in a studio and been there for 6 weeks. Other than that, they're only guessing. And, they're welcome to guess and speculate as much as they like. But we know that we were heading towards that. We could live, we're bringing the guitar up much more. We're using the piano sound a lot more than the kind of synth sound. Steve Lillywhite has gone. He's got a kind of reputation for having a big drum sound. Well, we've got a drummer who's got the biggest drum sound in Britain, if not the world. And I just think it wasn't so much as Steve giving us that. We were heading that way, and he just happened to bring it out. I think people say, "Oh, there's a distinctive Steve Lillywhite sound. Every band he works with sounds the same." Well, I'll be damned if John Armitrading sounds anything like Big Country to me. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So that's just kind of hogwash. I think what it is that in the past year he's worked with a lot of bands. He's worked with a few bands that are dead enthusiastic and have got a real kind of joy of life and what they're doing. And Steve is a guy himself. I mean, you've met him. He's 28. He looks a bit 18, and he's just one of these guys who can he can do it all. He can be the last man to his bed and the first man up in the morning. Mm-hmm. And nothing. He was great. You see, he was great with me because for me, often making records is a process of lying. I just, you know, I always say, oh, I've got the lyrics kind of ready, and I'll sing the night. But with Steve, there was almost a kind of sport involved that you wanted to let the team down, sort of thing. If you said you're going to sing the night, you just have to do it.
Has he made you sing better, do you think? Or, you know, has he improved your technique in any way?
I think he did in a kind of understated way. Just the same thing with Charlie and myself and the band. He just said, you're a really good band, go in and play, don't worry about any idea of a pursuit for perfection or something. Just go in for a performance, because when you perform it's worthwhile. And Steve learnt a lot of things because he worked in a couple of records with Eno, and Eno taught him a lot of great things. Mm-hmm. Like, for instance, Charlie, when Charlie uses a lot of effects live on stage, other producers wouldn't let him use these effects. They would wait to the mix before putting them on, but Steve would just let them put on echoes and just the whole thing. So we just went in and played like a band. We could see each other when we were playing, and everyone was involved. And I just think that, I mean, I'm not going to start criticising New Gold Dream or anything, but I just think for the first time with this record, as somebody pointed out, I think it's the first record that on the day everyone,
yeah,
the band, the producer and the engineer gave 100%.
Yeah, because I'd said to you earlier that it struck me as being the first Simple Minds band album, because when you look back there was always some kind of division, whether it was in the songwriting or the drumming personnel or whatever. There was always some kind of division, but in this one you can see everybody's contribution immediately.
Yeah, that's right. I just think, you know, perhaps before when we got in the studio we tended to be a little bit kind of precious.
Mm-hmm.
But with this one there was a kind of enthusiasm of it was almost our first album, and who knows, maybe our last album. Just kind of go in there and do it.
Now, there's a vocal trespasser on this track, Steve's girlfriend Kirsty McCall. How did she get roped into singing backing vocals in a couple of the tracks, and most notably Street Hassle?
Well, we met her last year. To be honest, I didn't know who she was, but she was hanging about the studio, and Derek knew her kind of first off, and she came in, and she's really
bought a coffee if there's a guy worse than the chip shop.
She's a really chatty young lady, but she's lovely, and she was just kind of hanging around, and then, you know, we wanted a girl's voice on, and she started to sing, and it really it suited well. Steve wasn't a kind of advocate for it, because at that time he didn't know who she was, but since then they've fallen deeply in love, and they're engaged and about to be be married, I think.
As part of the Simple Minds Marriage Bureau.
Best of luck to them.
Okay, here it is, Street Hassle.
Sexy one smiled in dismay. She pulled out for 20s, cause she liked round figures. Everybody stayed for a day. Oh babe, I'm on fire and you know I admire you. Buy it, why don't we slip away? Although I'm sure you're certain it's a rarity me flirting. Sha-la-la-la, lay her on. Showed her where he coming from. And sha-la-la-la-la, he made love to her gently, just like she had never come. And sha-la-la-la-la, sha-la-la-la, when the sun rose and she made to leave. Sha-la-la-la-la, sha-la-la-la, you know you don't want to regret it.
a Lou Reed composition from the album Sparkle in the Rain called Street Hassle. The other thing that struck me about the Barland concerts was the thing you're looking at the moment, the concert programme. It features some notes from the forthcoming Simple Minds book. When can we expect to see that?
I'm not sure, because that's been kind of shelved.
Shelved?
Mm-hmm.
Why?
I don't know, sometimes we're our worst enemies, because we try and take on so much and we deal things out and then shut ourselves away from them. And what we did is we got this guy, Adam Sweeten, who writes for the Melody Maker, and he has a very, very good friend of ours, but he went about for the past year and a half and he's collected a lot of like facts about the band together. But I feel that there's still something kind of missing. I think we still have to give them more to mm-hmm. get over in the book, some of the atmosphere of the records. I know that's a kind of intangible thing and I don't actually know how to go about it. But I just thought in reading what you'd done, it wasn't quite enough.
Was it a bit too comical, do you think?
No, not even quite that. It was just very he came out with us on and he saw some he I don't know if he was a jinx or something, but he was with us in Canada when we had a terrible experience. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. He was with us in Germany when it was a low part for us, and some of the comments in it and things, it looked as though we weren't enjoying ourselves. Mm-hmm. Which I think Adam he tends to veer on the, when he's talking about the band, as though we're carrying the weight of the world on our mm-hmm. like our shoulders, like for most of the time, which is hardly the case.
Have you commissioned him to write this book? I mean, do you get the final say about, you know, I like this and I don't like that, throw that out, keep that in? I mean, is that the idea?
Well, if it's you know, official book, it's meant to be approved by the band, and it's just that I think a book has become just like part of the next kind of stage along, and we could see it coming, you know, the mm-hmm. the gigs, the books, or whatever. And I just think if they're going to be there, you should try and do as good a job in them as possible. And I think we're learning now, not just to go ahead and just say yeah to everything. Mm-hmm. We have to kind of slow the pace down a bit. I mean, I really want to do a brilliant film this year mm-hmm. as well of the band. It's easier said than done. I think mm-hmm. I think we learnt a lot
to tie in with a live album type thing.
If it was good, yeah. I think just now might be a good time to do it, because this is going to be a crossing point for the band yet mm-hmm. again. And there's a lot of the you know, older songs that we're playing just now that, because they've got a new arrangement, they've got a new life to them, and it would be good to record them, and it would also kind of justify them not just being the same kind of arrangements as on the records. But there's a certain kind of like stigma that goes with a live album. It's usually when the band's run out of material, and to be honest, there hasn't been a lot of good ones. But it's something we would, you know, if we made money, we would really, really invest it that way in a good mm-hmm. good film and in a good live album.
So, I mean, are you talking about 1984 for that, or hopefully?
I think towards the end of 1984. We've got a lot coming up over the next few months, but I think there's something just now. We've obviously had a lot of encouragement for the videos of Waterfront, The Speed Your Love.
Right, we'll hear a bit more about what the band have got planned for the next few months, but the time is now. Mines and a song called The Kick Inside of Me. If you've just joined the programme, this is Billy Sloan on Radio Clyde, all the way through until 2 a.m. this Friday morning with my special live studio guest, Jim Kerr. Good morning once again.
Good morning.
Right, The Kick Inside of Me, I think, on the Sparkle in the Rain album, is your finest vocal performance. There is a bit in the tour programme which describes how, you know, the song came about, you know, in the latter stages. I mean, was it more or less a case of the band going for an actual live take?
Yeah, I think it's that kind of song. It's the kind of thing Simple Minds would jam, and it's a kind of song that really shows it shows some of the influences that the band have got. When I hear the opening drum beats of that, it makes me think of Lust for Life mm-hmm. or something. And that kind of song, that kind of style of song, is really up Steve's street. And I remember when I was young, reading this interview with Pete Pete Townsend, and he was talking about one of the tracks that The Who had made, and while doing it, the bass player was hitting it so hard that his thumb started to bleed.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the same goes for that track. When Derek Forbes was doing the bass overdub to it, the studio, he was in the control room, and the studio was crowded, and we were just all standing around him in a circle, and he was just hitting it, and everyone was cheering him right on, and at the end, his thumb really was, it was bust open, and so it really was a case of, giving it everything that he had.
I mean, compared to, the polish and the refinement, if you like, of the New Gold Dream album, it's almost at the other extreme. It's a real, raw, pretty basic track to have on a Simple Minds album. Did you have any qualms or reservations about doing something like that?
From the word go, no. I mean, when you come outside, we knew some of the jibes we would get, and we knew, the whole kind of raucous thing, but I just think that we have a tremendous kind of courage and belief in what we do, and we just think that if we make records that we believe in and we want to hear, we just have this kind of faith that there's people out there like us, and they'll attach themselves to it in the same way. I do understand some people, maybe they say, well, New Gold Dream's my album, and I don't like it compared to your new one, or I like this song much better than that style of song. But I just see records. I think there must be a parallel between making records and making films. And if Roman like Polanski does Tess, and then he does the next one is Chinatown, there's no point in trying to connect them.
Mm-hmm.
They're totally different things, and they're totally different style of songs. The same way as we're doing a tour just now, it's got a show which is a certain production too. I mean, maybe the next tour we do, maybe the band won't even, utter a word to the audience or mm-hmm, something. It's mm-hmm. just, I'm having a lot of good fun, actually, just kind of, when you say you'd no qualms doing it.
Mm-hmm.
I know what you mean about that, especially in Britain, some of the press we've been getting lately. Mm-hmm. It's as though the band's getting too big for their boots, and there's certain people who normally would have ignored us now. Mm-hmm. They'll go to the extent of writing 4 or 5 paragraphs and saying how crap we are.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know, you just kind of live and you grow. And
a couple of people have written in, and one of the criticisms, one of the few criticisms in fact I've heard of the current batch of Simple Minds shows, that is that compared to the shows you did at Barland before Christmas, the band are actually playing less new material now than you were then. I mean, wouldn't it have been better to play some more tracks from Sparkle in the Rain? The Kick Inside, and White Hot Day, which you played before Christmas but don't play now?
I understand what you're saying there. It's just, how can I say this?
I mean, I know the set really does seem the right length, and there is hardly a bit of deadwood in the set, and it would be, a shame to start chopping and changing for mm-hmm. the sake of it, but obviously a lot of people will have bought Sparkle in the Rain, and, compared to, as I say, Barland before Christmas, they're not hearing, as much new material as they did then.
Well, I think, if we had come on stage tonight again for a second encore, we may have done Kick Inside, or we may have done Street Hassle, but we couldn't even think about coming on stage tonight for a second encore, because apart from just about everyone in the hall being dead, there's a lot of people at the front have been mm-hmm. squashed for mm-hmm. an hour and a half. And I also think the way the band's driving the audience just now, and the way the audience is turn driving the band, It's pretty hairy in there,
mm-hmm,
and,
mm-hmm.
and I don't know, if we were doing somewhere like the Apollo, and it was a seated venue, and
mm-hmm.
there was a cam and a control, I think the set would be different. But I don't know, it gives something to look forward to. I think when we tried White Hot Day, some nights it worked, other nights it didn't work.
Mm-hmm.
I think I don't know, I suppose it's just next tour we do, maybe we'll do some stuff, and
mm-hmm.
other people are saying, why aren't you doing that? I travel mm-hmm. and celebrate.
Yeah, because a lot of people write in, and obviously people who've caught on to Simple Minds from New Gold Dream onwards, and they write in, week out to the programme saying, when Simple Minds come this time, do you think they'll play anything off Reel to Reel, and do you think they'll play anything off Empires and Dance? I mean, will there be a time when you will go back to any of that for the benefit of people who've caught up with you in the latter day, as opposed to, being with you all along?
It depends. See, it goes way far above the music. It goes just now. There's a kind of there's a kind of, I don't know, a lyrical thing involved in the set as well. I think some of the songs we're doing at that period, although I still stick by them, a lot of them are very nihilistic. And I just think, you know, there's enough kind of stupid nihilism going about just now with dummy bands like kind of, you know, the Birthday Party, Alien Sex Fiend, and various other kind of New York junkies. Without us adding, what we're putting over just now is songs which have a very, which I think do have a heart of gold to them, and which are determined without trying to make, you know, get on a kind of soapbox and give any speech. They are kind of like a determined to make. To try and make people rise above their kind of situation. I would love to do, I think, a song like Premonition's really, you know, a really kind of classic bit of, I think it's a really dramatic song, and we played it, we played it in Dublin, for instance. But, I don't know, some songs, although you stick by them, they're like, they're just like jackets that don't maybe fit anymore. And I wouldn't dare say that we would never do them again. In fact, I would like to do one song from the first album, Someone.
I'd like to do,
and I can see a link between that song and what we're doing just now.
Of course there is, yeah.
But I just don't know. It's a bit like, I heard, you know, a couple of weeks ago someone writing into you saying, why don't you play this and why don't you play that? And you kind of said, well, you know, this is my show and I just play what I like. I mean, I'm not going to say that to the to the audience, but we're playing the songs we're playing on stage just now are the songs we think are the songs we're kind of living for the moment. And we could go through the motions with some of the older songs and maybe, you know, satisfy the taste and bring out some of the memories, but I don't know, I think we should just enjoy the moment for what it is. You can't really play for two hours under the kind of the heat and circumstance which you've got in Barrowland. And if we did, we would obviously incorporate some of these songs, but I don't know, the records are there for them, and they can play them.
Right, let's talk about another track from Sparkle in the Rain. I remember a very late night with Charles Burchill and myself in a certain London hotel, sitting about 5 a.m, and he told me how this song came about, and the way he described it, he said that the song, to use his phraseology, wasn't happening, and you were running out of studio time, there was a band waiting to get in, and it wasn't a panic exactly, but it was, you know, it was pretty last minute. Is that how East of Easter, you know, came about?
Yeah, it was actually, it was the kind of coda from a song. It's the end of a song which had three verses and two choruses that we never used. And it was funny because during the making of the album, this song was always a kind of centre point. But we knew there was something lacking, and sometimes it just takes to the very last minute. And I tried to sing on it, and just the way we had built it up, there was no flow to it. It had a lot of drama, but there was no flow. But we loved this kind of end kind of raindrop riffs, I call it, these little keyboard things that Charlie's playing, Mick's playing and Charlie's playing as well. And I just thought that, you know, I said that we should just use this bit and link it with that, and we made a kind of tape loop. And I was still bluffing. I was saying, I've got an idea for lyrics, and they were saying, well, that's good, but I really didn't have an idea. And I went in, and in two takes, there it was. It was just, I had my notebook there, and I'd been reading this story about the Lebanon, and as opposed to me coming out and writing a kind of, you know, an anti-war song, I don't know, I just had a few lines down there, and it just seemed to fit together almost instinctively.
Right, here it is, East at Easter. Let's, you know, talk about the various components which go to make up Simple Minds, because again in the tour brochure, each member of the band, excluding yourself, has a description. You know, Charlie's the life and soul of the party, and Dan's Dan, your man, etc, etc. Tell the listeners a wee bit about, you know, each individual member of the band, Derek, Mick, Charlie and Mel.
Well, I don't know, I think with every band, any band that's at all kind of special, there's a kind of chemistry that runs through people that are playing in it. I think in some ways, it's dead unlikely how we fit together, because, you know, really when the music stops, everyone does their own things. Like Mick's especially kind of quiet, and he's totally happy just, you know, listening to things like classical music, or drinking a few wee whiskies, or stuff like that. It really doesn't, it really doesn't have much to say apart from, you know, living and learning and mm-hmm. and growing in his music. On the other hand, Derek Forbes is, I really think he's a brilliant comedian. I mean, I think if ever the band was to stop, which it will, Derek Forbes definitely has a future, but he's got a bit of a problem because as soon as you stick a microphone in front of him, he freezes.
Mm-hmm.
But he has this kind of natural born.
When he's on the bus and stuff like that.
Yeah, and he's fantastic at kind of impersonating people. And he does a brilliant fast wit. I don't know if anyone ever saw the video Derek made of a version of Midyear doing Vienna. It was really classic, I thought. He's definitely, as I say, he's kind of my hero, man of the people, Derek Forbes. He likes his bed a lot.
Uh-huh. He's always last to leave when we've got to be down in the lobby for 10 o'clock. He's the last man down.
Like, he's terrible like that. He also usually keeps his stage makeup on for about 3 weeks. He's still got on eyeliner from Dublin. But Charlie, on the other hand, Charlie, just there when we left the hotel, we saw Charlie walking down the road in the pouring rain and the snow, and Paul and I said to him, "Where are you going?" He went, "Hey, I nae bother him, I'm just going for a walk." And we were like, "Aye, sure, Charlie." He's a bit of a kind of unlikely character mm-hmm. as well. He loves stuff like, see, Charlie's great. You can talk to anyone on any level, be it a politician or a school kid, and I really do think, you know, Charlie Birchall is he's a living kind of legend.
Your guiding light, as you see on stage.
He is. No one's any bigger or smaller to him,
mm-hmm.
And people really attach themselves to it. He's great for me. He really holds me back a lot,
mm-hmm.
and especially when I'm getting dead confused or,
mm-hmm.
you know, getting into one of my moods, he can always kind of get me out of it.
And last but by no means least, the man who has the world's most infectious laugh.
You're talking about the cake man.
Yeah.
Mel Gaynor. I don't think, to be honest, I don't think Mel knows quite what's going to hit him in the past year and a half. He's getting the credit that I think he does deserve. I have absolutely no qualms saying that he's the best, you know, young drummer in the world, because he is. If he was to leave the band tomorrow, I would mm-hmm. still say that. It'd be terribly unfortunate, but I think credit where credit's, you know, due. He's played with some dodgy outfits, everyone.
The Nolans?
Yeah, Samson.
Samson?
Yeah.
Tell the people your nickname for him when he puts the oil in his hair before leaving to go to the gig. Because he played for a spell with Imagination, Legion and Imagination. Tell listeners what the band call him.
I can't even think. He's been called everything from Ken Dodd to the Cake Man.
Music and Lights.
Oh, Music and Lights. Yeah, he used to wear a nappy on stage. he was called the Cake Man because on a flight to Los Angeles, it was really dead and boring, and he was in a deep sleep, really peaceful sleep, and Charlie and I just couldn't, you know, resist hitting him with this, like, rock hard icing from mm-hmm. this cake, and he wakened up and he was in a ferocious mood, and there was all bits of cake and he's like his curls and stuff, and we were just calling him the Cake Monster, and I think he was going to beat us up quite badly if he'd get round to it. And ever since then he's just been called the Cake Man. I mean, I feel at least kind of, I feel about 6 feet, but when he's behind me on stage, mm-hmm. I can really feel him at the back, and he really he hits the kit so hard, and every night I think he just kind of gets me up there and drives me on.
Mm-hmm.
I think Mel's got a really big future no matter what he does. He's got a great scope in music, everything from reggae to jazz to funk and again rock he can play. So I don't know where Mel's future lies. I think he's having a great time just now, and he especially feels great at the kind of affection that the Glasgow audience mm-hmm. has given him. I mean, he does, he just looks on Glasgow as his hometown now, mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. he'll come in, you know, and he's picked up some of our language. He's got a little kid with him, actually the little kid's up in Glasgow just now, and he'll go, "Yeah, I was going to go down to the gig, but the wine was greeting," and I mean, he's picked up some of the kind of jargon, but he's really, really nice guy, and I think ever since he's come in, he's really he's tightened the whole unit up. I think him and Derek Forbes together are definitely a special special rhythm unit.
You spend a lot of time away from your native Glasgow. I mean, when you travel back, this is a letter from a girl called Jeanette in Springburn who was wanting to know, you know, what Simple Minds thought when, you know, they travelled to the exotic spots around the world and came back and saw the tenements of Glasgow. I mean, you, with the Waterfront single, you really did wear your affection and your love for the native city in your sleeve. I mean, does it still get you that way when you come back and see things like the Barrowland and go walks and that kind of thing?
I think you really need to. You need to leave the place where you know you've lived in to really appreciate it, because you know you see it every day and you take it for granted, and you know, we went away for just about a year, kind of a solid, and you look around and it's true, we saw some pretty eye-opening places and we saw some really kind of exotic places, but you know, where you're from is where you're from, and there's a strength there, and as well as that, there's this image of Glasgow around the world, which I just think is dead and gone now, and I think it's about time that it's changed. I just think there is, I can feel it. It might sound really romantic, but I can feel a new sky above Glasgow. I think when the government makes cuts in London, it's always, you know, the northern parts that kind of get it, and it's been bleak in Glasgow for ages now, and I don't think it can get any bleaker, but I just think the city's taking on a beauty. When they had the marathon, for instance, on TV, it just looked so good, and I just think we've got a kind of duty and a responsibility not to go with that kind of constant hard man.
I mean, when you're away and people hear that you're a Glasgow band, I mean, is that something that you've got to overcome in terms of they think, you know, God, he's from Glasgow, I wonder what he's going to be like?
Yeah, I mean, you do. Actually, the bus driver, listen to this one, anyone out there listening to this, the bus driver who's driving in our tour,
Reg Varney,
he swears he was in a pub in Glasgow 2 years ago and he saw a guy getting his arm cut off.
He told us that.
I mean, can you believe that? And I was saying to him, it happens every night. I mean, I know it's Glasgow's an emotional place, but where there's bad, there's good. I mean, you could see that in Belfast last year. I just hope Glasgow, I do really feel patriotic towards Glasgow now. I hope if there's anybody there who feels they could, you know, write a song or get in a band or travel abroad, just, you know, do it, put everything you've got into it. And I think it's really, really amazing how much you can do if you put everything you've got into it. I go around a lot and I talk to a lot of people, young people my own age and people younger, and you know, they talk about the band and they talk about the gig and the records, and then I try to get them to talk about themselves, and I say, well, you know, they're talking about my new gold dream, and I say, well, what's your dream or what's your vision and what's this, and they say, well, you know, I'm just me and I don't know, I don't really do anything and there's no chance for me, and I say, well, why is that? And they start to quote, you know, figures, so many unemployed and they've got no money and they've got no this. I just think that I just really, really, you know, believe you can rise above it. I really do. I don't think there's people who are chosen. I think it's just kind of amazing if you want something and you really want that more than anything else. If you put everything you've got into it, I think you can see, you know, you can see results. And I just hope that Glasgow, especially young people in Glasgow, pick themselves up and get out. I think there's a lot of people helping. People are looking at Glasgow just now through Bill Forsyth. Uh-huh. And there's a couple of other authors and poets as well. And I would, you know, I don't think I'll ever really leave Glasgow.
You said earlier that any time the government of cuts, always seems to be the north that gets it first. You mentioned the government on stage at the Barrowland last night, and you know, over the next 20 minutes or so, we hope to have the result in the programme of the Chesterfield by election. I mean, when you're here and there's any kind of local election or a general election, do you vote?
I haven't been here when there's been a vote, but I've got no qualms in saying that I was really like shattered that not enough young people voted Labour, although I understood to an extent, because it was in a shambles, the party, but it's not so much that. I mean, I'm not going to get into that sort of thing. It's just a kind of, I think the biggest danger and disease just now, apart from drugs, is kind of this kind of apathy, because we've never really experienced. I think apathy is it's the biggest illness, and we've never experienced how to get out of it. And I think there'll be a lot of people that perhaps can get out of it. They just won't be able to lift themselves above that kind of, I don't know, the depression that's around just now. And it's such a pity, because I think the world isn't necessarily a bad place. It's just that when you read, you know, newspapers and the news, it just tends to focus only on that. I just think there's something more than, I don't know, these kind of spoils. I just mentioned the government because I just think, you see Thatcher on TV, and how can she really, you know, how can she at all relate to anybody here? You think of a Glasgow, you know, you think of someone's character here, how could you relate to that thing? God, revolution in the air, that's what I say.
Right, before we hear a bit more about yourself and Simple Minds, let's start with your choice of music. You play a lot of weird and wonderful things on the Simple Minds tour bus, and you lock yourself away in your room and stick the Walkman on and listen to things which when I looked through your case last week, surprised me. Your first choice is what?
It's T-Rex, and it's Get It On, because I thought tonight when you asked me to come along and play a few songs, I could have sort of dug out some of the more obscure things, but I trust that you'll do that in the next few weeks. I would just like to play some of the records from the past, the bands that I would go and see, and just have a wee bit of a party for the next half an hour. This is Get It On. It's one of the best singles ever.
The high
from the classic T-Rex album Electric Warrior, Jim Kerr's first choice of the morning, and of course the unmistakable sound of Mark Bolan and Get It On. Let's talk about, you know, you mentioned earlier that you had, you know, gone all around the world and you'd been away to Australia and New Zealand doing some festivals recently. You more or less came back to find yourselves in the position of having an album that went straight in at number one. What must that have felt like?
Well, for the first kind of half an hour, it was sheer delight, to be honest. Then, you know, I just had to sit back and think about it and just think about the past kind of 5 years and 6 years and growing up to that. But being kind of realistic, I could sense that we have such a fantastic live kind of following that I knew it was going to go in high. And there was a certain amount of luck involved. But I especially felt good. The great thing is seeing, as I've said before, is always seeing the kind of delight in the faces of people who have been behind you for a long time, because it takes a lot of work and a lot of involvement from a lot of people outside the band to get an album to go in as high as that, and just to build the band up as much as that. And I don't know, there was just a lot of people kind of getting in touch and just saying, like, you know, I told you it would happen. But I'm not going to say we're blasé about it. It was great, without a doubt. But you know, we were just to go on tour the next day, and that was it. But it was definitely, I think it probably hasn't really hit us, to be honest. It's been happening. It's gone in really high.
How many has it sold so far? Have you had any kind of figure?
In Britain, it's sold about 170,000. But it's gone in very high in a lot of different charts around the world. And we still were getting the earliest kind of feedbacks from the United States as well, and that's where we'll be spending a lot of time this year.
When you were younger and you were going to gigs like, you know, early Genesis gigs and Roxy Music gigs and David Bowie gigs and stuff like that, did you ever think, you know, when you must have had in your mind an idea of forming a band, did you ever think that, you know, 5, 6, 7 years later, here you would be, you know, receiving the same kind of adulation and attention that the people that you were paying money to go and see were getting at that time?
No, and I still don't really see it that way. I don't know. I just seem kind of detached. I was looking at the audience kind of tonight, and I don't know what it is. I think with there's something going on just now with certain bands that they haven't. Isn't as if we just arrived with a, you know, a burst and get in there as bands like, you know, Roxy Music did. They just arrived, and David Bowie didn't really, but he was nothing, and then suddenly it was just a kind of a phenomenon. I think isn't it really the case with this band and a couple of others of our contemporaries? But I think I don't know. I always think of kind of people bands, and the bands that spring to your mind would be bands like The Jam and The Clash and things like that. But I think in a understated way, Simple Minds have become adopted by the people in some ways. I feel great to be part of a band that's number one, and I know it's still a band and not a product. I mean, I realise there's certain things, you know, to get that record there. I realise that we're signed to a multi-corporate kind of company, and our records are made in a huge factory, but we haven't really had to compromise or sell ourselves one bit. We've hardly had to do one thing that we haven't enjoyed.
No, but what I mean though is that when you were sort of saving up £4 of your hard-earned pocket money or cash when you were working or whatever, and you know, buying a ticket to go and see somebody like Brian Ferry and getting off on the gig, I mean, did you ever think that you would be in a similar position, you know, 5, 6, 7 years later?
No, because I was a lot more kind of introvert than I am just now. I've had to learn to come out in the past few years and kind of speak to strangers.
Because, I mean, on stage is probably the most extrovert you ever get, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It's kind of like a perverse, just playing that record there, Get It On. It used to make me think of record sessions that I would go to, and I would never dance or anything like that.
That's right.
I feel tacky. I just, you know, or else I would wait until the very end and kind of pluck up the courage. But, you know, I would always be kind of sort of in the kitchen playing Tig. Or something like that. I was never, I don't know.
I mean, what kind of teenager were you, do you think, looking back?
Dead, I don't know. Dead average. I think, in a good time, I was I spent all my teenage years in Tory Glen, and it was, I wouldn't swap it for one bit. Mm-hmm. It was great, and just a lot of mates and things, and I just think that we're pretty fortunate, in as much that I had a lot of older mates who put music my way, music that I couldn't hear on radio.
Mm-hmm.
Then, you know, you just couldn't hear it on Radio 1 at the time, stuff like the Velvet Underground and stuff like Alice Cooper then, The Doors,
mm-hmm.
New York Dolls, and I think it gave me a kind of appetite.
I've been out with you a few times when we've been in the most ridiculous places, whether it's a club or a quiet restaurant or walking down the street or looking in a shop window, and you can always see people doing a double take, and you know, people will come up and say, well, will you sign this and sign that, and can I get my picture taken with you? I mean, how do you handle stardom, if you like? I mean, that must surely have sunk in, because, you know, you walk down the road and people say, that's that punter who sings in Simple White.
Yeah, there's this thing about when people see you on TV and stuff, they still can't really believe that medium, that they can see someone on TV and then see them in the street. I don't know, I think to an extent we have had to learn to coexist. Some people are really good when they come up to you, and some people are really rude, and they just kind of barge in there, and it really does feel like you've been sort of hit in the head with something. Someone just, you know, you're just walking down, it's a quiet day and you're thinking about something, and someone just barges up and says, geezer poster. And you just think, well, I haven't got a poster on me, actually. But I don't know, it's some of, to be honest, it's,
I mean, is it nice being famous?
I don't think I'm famous.
Oh, come on.
No, I don't think I am.
Well, I mean, there's 20 people waiting outside Radio Clyde at the moment. They wouldn't be waiting there unless the guy who was in here was famous.
I think, you know, you're talking about Simon, you know, Simon Le Bon, or there's I think the band's bigger than me, and the music's bigger.
No, well,
than me.
I don't mean, you know, singling you out. I mean the same for Charlie and Mel, and you know, but, you know, did you ever think you would be famous? I mean, did you ever think you could be a candidate for This Is Your Life?
Because, a contender.
Yeah, when you were 16 and in Tory Glen, it wasn't looking good, was it?
It was looking good to an extent, because I just never... You just don't know what's around the corner. I just think, to an extent, nobody knows what they can do. You can see these Bill Forsyth movies, and you see people who've never acted in their life.
Mm-hmm.
And they're just... I mean, it just takes you by surprise. They're just there, and everyone's got something, and it's just, I just think that it's got to be encouraged to be brought out more.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like, you know, when a place like kind of Glasgow, you don't, you know, it isn't as if there's a drama school on every corner, or there's a film school, or it's just when you're brought up like in an industrial place, all you're led to believe is that you're good in a sort of industrial sort of way, and when there's no industry, what's left for you? Well, there's nothing. But I think it's changing now. There's fantastic characters here, and there's fantastic stories. And
your dad.
And I would just like, someone said to me the other night, a cynic, he was saying, do you think your band is, you know, is your band going to change a generation and stuff? And I was just looking at him as if to say, you're an idiot. Because of course we're not mm-hmm. going to do that, and we're not going to try. But my only answer to him was, does it matter if we change it? You know, a generation. I think we've probably sold, all in all, nearly 1 million records now. And I think, I said to him, do you think we've changed one person or helped one person? And he said, oh yeah, you probably have. And you've probably helped a good deal more. And I said, well, is that not important?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it is.
Right, let's, before we go on with any more questions, set the competition to win a copy of Sparkling the Rainbow. Got a couple of lines in the studio here, and I decided that, as probably most of the people who will enter the contest will already have a copy of Sparkling the Rain, or if they don't, they should be whipped. We try and make the question pretty hard. Now, I've set a couple of questions, if you can think of any good and well, but I've set a couple of questions. The first question is, who topped the bill on Simple Minds' first ever live appearance? Who topped the bill in Simple Minds' first ever live appearance? And the second one, I reckon, could be a tiebreaker, because it really is slightly harder. On Sparkling the Rain, on the song Speed Your Love, Jim Kerr sings a line which contains about five words or something like that, and it is two very famous song titles in quick succession. One is an old Motown classic, and the other one is a classic song of the 60s. I want to know what the songs were, and who originally recorded them. So that's Who Topped the Bill the first time Simple Minds ever played live. That was at Satellite City, God knows when. And the second question is, on Speed Your Love, the part of the lyric features two, whether intentionally or not, famous song titles, one after the other, one an old 60s Tamla Motown classic and one a 70s classic. What were the songs and who was responsible for them? Put your answers on a postcard to Simple Minds Contest, care of Billy Sloan, Radio Clyde, PO Box 261 in Clydebank, and we'll draw the lucky winners out the hat next week, and you'll get an autographed copy of Sparkle in the Rain. We were talking a few weeks ago about some of the gigs that Simple Minds did on the way up, and one of the ones that we were remembering was the night that you supported Susie and the Banshees at the Apollo, and then packed the stuff in the van and belted through Edinburgh to support the Pleasers. I mean, looking back to those times, I mean, what kind of other weird and wonderful gigs do you remember? I mean, supporting the Pleasers.
I know, that's pretty...
That's pretty wild.
We supported 999 at the... we supported Hawkwind as well. Who else did we support? I don't know. There's been hundreds, but they were really good fun. We supported... I think we supported the Backstabbers.
Mm-hmm.
Jimmy Loser. I don't know, but then, on the other hand, we've supported people like Peter, you know, Gabriel. Last year we played with amazing bands like U2, Van Morrison, and then just last month we played with some of the best bands in the world, the Talking Heads, the Pretenders, and I'm sure there's a lot more out there just about to come up.
Mm-hmm. What of the local bands that you've heard, you know, you've had a chance to hear of impression, or what new bands of impression that you've heard recently?
I really loved the stuff you let me hear from the Cocteau Twins, although I keep reading them slagging us off, but there you go. I think they're really, really good.
Mm-hmm.
But obviously they're getting a lot of acclaim just now, and that's good. I don't know, you're always dead enthusiastic, and you put things my way, and I don't know, I start to pick it a bits and things. I don't know, I like
you like Lloyd Cole, didn't you? You heard that recently?
Yeah, I do. The demo, I think it was a demo. I heard it on the show, and I thought it was dead good. And I started to talk to some people at Virgin about it right away. I don't know what was happening there. I like Bourgeois Bourgeois as well. Believe it or not. Who else? Oh, I'm not so sure. I don't know. I've got time for anyone who's like enthusiastic just now,
mm-hmm.
or seem at all like kind of passionate about what they're doing. You can see that they're putting more of themselves in it than just a surface thing.
Mm-hmm.
I love very much Billy, you know, McKenzie,
mm-hmm.
and I met him last month, and although I haven't heard his new stuff, I could just see, you know, he just had that kind of light in his eyes.
How was he behaving?
He's mad as a brush. Talking about goldfish and whippets and fairgrounds and stuff like that. He said a great story about wanting to throw himself down the stairs or something. I mean, he's mad, but he's great. He's definitely one for the future. I don't know who else do I like. I love the sound of the Frankie Goes to Hollywood, mm-hmm. single. When mm-hmm. the first time I heard that as well, I know a lot of other people like it too. But I think that's a bit of an achievement as a dance record.
Mm-hmm.
It's quite stunning. And I like things. I like the Police album, even though, you know, you tend to take a band like that for granted because they're so popular. But because they're popular doesn't mean that they're no good. And I like very much stuff like Bob Marley and lots of different things.
From a personal point of view, what are you looking forward to most over the next few months? I mean, from the point of view of ambition, what ambitions are you hoping to fulfil before very long? I mean, what are you looking forward to having happen to you?
I've kind of changed. I used to have this kind of idea of, you know, everything was a race, and at the end of it, there was a prize. I don't think it's like that. I think the prize is the race itself, and I've kind of settled in that way. I really believe in songwriters again. When you use that term, you think of, like, you tend to think of, you know, middle-aged kind of MOR acts, but I really believe in the power of a song again, and I think songwriters should be really, really encouraged. I think anyone can write a really good song. You could be sitting, you don't even have to have a band. If you can even play a few chords on a piano or a guitar, you can just write. I just feel that a great song can come from it. It's just like that kind of trade has been lost. It's all been bands, and there's a lot of great bands, and the bands have a good feel, but I feel like ourselves, we're only beginning to become songwriters in a sense just now. And I just, as I say, I believe in the song. I think rock has to be broken up, and a lot of it has to be smashed, this kind of generation thing. I think there's no reason to think that, you know, if you think of someone like Graham Greene can write a brilliant book when he's 65, who's to say that, I know it's obvious, but John Lennon couldn't have, or John Cale couldn't, or Lou Reed couldn't, or David Bowie, or Chrissy Hynde for that matter. And I just think once you start, you know, getting kids, imagine kids at the age of 5 being in a studio, if they could play. I know it sounds kind of weird and everything, but I think the whole kind of, I said it before in radio and someone else's programme, but this whole kind of vanity and rock and this whole generation thing about, you know, you see like twats like Wham dressing up and we're bad boys and like telling their parents that, you know,
they've got to stay up to 12 o'clock at night, so.
Aye, and they need their mas to cook breakfast for them. It's all that has to be smashed. That's been going on since Eddie Cochran. As you see, rock is a dead and valuable folk thing again. I think you'll get these really heavy situations coming on. You'll get some brilliant young guy who'll just be able to put his finger on it and say in 3 minutes what would normally take some people a lifetime to say.
Well, as always happens in these kind of programmes, we could really go on all night. You've got a pile of records in front of you, we're never going to get through any of them. It's 2:04. Thanks to you for coming in. I hope to see you socially and professionally very soon again. All the best with Barland tomorrow night. I will be there. I will be there. All the best with your 75 nights at Hammersmith Odeon. And I hope everything goes well for you in Europe, America and Japan. Quickly, when can we expect to see you back playing here? When will the band be back on stage in Glasgow, do you think, roughly?
I really don't know.
Before the year's up?
I don't know, but I'd like to just say to everyone who's came to the gigs over the past year and everyone who waited 14 months for us to come back, that we really do appreciate it, and we are going to take away the memory of the past couple of months and the gigs that we've done in Glasgow. We'll definitely carry them around with us, and it doesn't really matter when we come back. I just know that if they can wait, it'll be worthwhile.
Right, well, as I say, we could have gone on to 9 o'clock later this morning. I'm sorry that, you know, the tour has just really evaporated. a lot of good music and a lot of millions of things I wanted to ask, which we just don't have time for. I'm sorry. Thanks to you for coming in. We'll finish with another one of your favourite tracks. I'll see you next week, same time, same place, same channel. My thanks again to Jim Kerr for coming in. And we'll leave you this Friday morning with The Doors and Light My Fire. Good night.
Would be untrue. You know that I would be a liar if I was to say to you, girl, we couldn't get much higher. Come on, baby, light my fire. Come on, baby, light my fire. Try to set the night on fire. The time to hesitate is through. No time to wallow in the mire. Try now, we can only lose. And our love become a funeral pyre. Come on, baby, light my fire. Come on, baby, light my fire. Try to set the night on.